because of unforgiveness. I'm going to break down a few of the list of sickness today that came from unforgiveness. It will not be a very thorough list, and I'm going to encourage you to do a little bit of digging on the internet, because after I'm done today, you will get an idea on what are the list of sickness that is given to us by anger and unforgiveness. I am telling you, once you will learn how to forgive, so many sicknesses that you feel in your body will go away. They will just go away. I'm telling you this. Every time I travel and I leave the country, I'm always in a long fast. So if I travel 5 times a year, either I will enter a 21-day fast before I travel or a 40-day fast before I travel. And during those times, I never get sick. Sometimes you are led to believe that if you don't eat, you get sick. Actually, the Bible said that if you fast in Isaiah 58, it will expedite your healing. In fact, there are so many things that we eat that give sickness to our body. And when you fast, you give time for your body to repair and to recover, and they will be flushed out of your system. There are new things that you are going to learn tonight. You are going to learn new vocabularies, and some of these things are very, very new to you. And I'm going to guarantee you that one session is not enough. As always with all our topics, one session is not enough. You know what we did with the Healing Glory Conference? We did a little of teaching on the prophetic. We did a little of teaching in the supernatural. We did a little of teaching on sexual healing. We did a little teaching of financial healing. We did a little teaching of releasing forgiveness. We will do a little teaching of the apostolic anointing. But in reality, we conduct conferences by just that one session alone for 5 days. That's how broad the topic is. I'm going to teach you today the danger if we don't release forgiveness. And I'm going to bring you to some biblical passages and verses to show to you how the Lord Jesus Christ had given importance for us to forgive and why we should not retain anger inside of us. Let's go to the next slide. I want you to understand that unforgiveness is not only a destroyer of a relationship, it is a breakthrough killer. I want us to read Matthew chapter 5, verse 3 to 24. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 23, therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First go and be reconciled to your brother, then come and offer your gifts. I want you to understand that if there is any disagreements or if there is any wrong sentiments towards a brother in the Lord, the Lord Jesus Christ has taught us in the book of Matthew that even before we bring our offering to the altar, we need to learn to forgive those that have offended us. Because our gift, the acceptance of our gift that we present to the Lord, is affected if someone is complaining against you. You need to understand this. That if you are praying to God and a brother or a sister in the Lord has a complaint against you and you are aware that you have offended that person, it will do you good if you call or text the person or talk to the person face to face and say, sister or brother, I am so sorry that what I did offended you. Because I am telling you, once you say the word, I'm sorry, I apologize, I am telling you, that will help your gift or your prayers to God to be accepted. You see, God is not like a person that you can buy him out. What I'm trying to say to you is this. God is not like a person that maybe I will give God $1 million to forgive me. The truth of the matter is God does not need your money. You need God's money. What you need is to confess and repent of your sins and receive the forgiveness of the Lord. But you hold back your blessing not because you would like to be greedy, but you would like to see to it that you meet the basic requirements that will prevent you from not seeing your breakthrough. Forgiveness, reconciliation, they are a powerful tool in the kingdom for which breakthrough can be released and your prayers can be answered. So many believers have been praying and so many people are coming to us requesting for prayers, and I'm telling you, I am surprised to the level of so many unanswered prayers. I am so surprised. And I said to myself, there is something lacking in the teaching of the body of Christ among the ministers, that people in the churches are not seeing a breakthrough in their prayer. One of them is this. If you are aware that you have offended someone, go to that person and release forgiveness or ask for forgiveness. Because it will help in your prayer. So many people, sometimes even ministers, they are not comfortable in saying, I'm sorry. I am going to tell you, it will affect your praying. It is going to affect your ministry. And when you preach to people, you feel like you are speaking against a wall. Because God is not mocked. God has laid out foundations for which we can be effective in receiving an answer to our prayer. Glory to God. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 14 to 15, we are going to learn something new that the Lord Jesus Christ taught. He said this, for if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. Everybody say with me. For if you forgive men, when they sin against you, underline that or encircle that in your Bible. That is very important. When you forgive men if they sin against you, listen to what Jesus is saying. When they sin against you, in this life, people will sin against you. That is expected. If you think that no one will offend you in this life, you are not in reality. Because the Lord said, men will sin against you. It's expected. And sometimes it is you who sin against others. Because that is inevitable. What we are supposed to do is to release forgiveness when men sin against you. Here is one thing I have learned all throughout the time I was walking with God. That even if the person that asked for forgiveness for what they did on me, either they are aware of it or not, either it was intentionally done or not, I am already releasing forgiveness to them before they say sorry. I am releasing forgiveness to the nasty words that they have spoken. I am releasing forgiveness that they have misinterpreted me. They misunderstood me. That they don't like me. That they reject me. That they hate me. That they were envious of me. That they were jealous of me. I am releasing forgiveness to them in the name of Jesus. And if I can identify the person, I will also mention the person's name in prayer. And I say, God, I forgive the person that I think it totally misunderstood me. I forgive the person. And even if the person will not realize that he or she have angered me, I will still release forgiveness to the person. And my next prayer is this. Lord, forgive him for what he did, even though he is not convicted that what he have done is wrong. As I have forgiven him, forgive him as well. I am telling you, if you say that kind of prayer, you are going to live the secret place with not no heaviness in your chest, with no load in your chest. Because Jesus Christ said that. Look at here. Jesus Christ said that. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive your sin. If you retain unforgiveness in your heart, your own sins are retained. Say it with me. If I retain unforgiveness in my heart, my sins are retained. So imagine this. Even if you ask forgiveness of your sin, if you nurture unforgiveness towards others, your sins are still retained. How important is this principle that the Lord has taught us? And so many unanswered prayers are coming from this. Because you know what? They retain unforgiveness in their hearts, and they don't release forgiveness to their offenders. I am telling you, people of God, once you learn how to walk in forgiveness, no one can offend you. And one thing that I have noticed, once you are offended and you start to cultivate anger in your spirit, it will make you look ugly. It will just make you look ugly, because anger will not help to your beauty. Bitterness will not help to your beauty. And one thing that I have noticed, that ugly faces are not even ugly because of features. They are ugly because of the anger and offenses retained in their hearts. Because once you release forgiveness, your muscles will start to loosen up. It shows on your face. And your face will start to brighten up. I want you to understand, in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26 to 27, Apostle Paul, the writer of the book of Ephesians, mentioned something very significant. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26 to 27, in your anger, do not sin. Say with me, in your anger, do not sin.
In your anger,
do not let the sun go down while you are still angry. Oh, you didn't have to say that. Just repeat it when I say it. Verse 27, and do not give the devil a foothold. Anger and offense that are retained after sundown becomes a demonic stronghold. When someone offended you during the morning, or noontime, or during afternoon, see to it that you will release forgiveness before sundown. Even if there is a reason to be angry. Even if your anger is validated, you were abused, you were cursed, you were taken advantage. Someone borrowed you money and never decided to pay it back. And he said it right to your face, and you were offended. I am telling you, when you release forgiveness to the person, it doesn't mean that the person has no more debt to you. The debt is still there, but you don't want offense to become a demonic stronghold inside of you.
Amen.
Because look, this person already makes you upset, plus giving you a demonic stronghold. Thank you, but no thanks. In my marriage, my husband and I will see to it that before we go to bed to sleep, we need to release forgiveness to each other, even though I know he is wrong. And even though he knew it, I was wrong. So even before we settle that whatever we have disagreed upon, because sometimes you don't have enough time in the day to sit down and talk. Sometimes your body is just tired. Sometimes it is your mind that is tired. You can process everything. But you know what? Because we develop the principle of releasing forgiveness, the next day is a new day.
Amen.
And sometimes I will tell my husband, you know, honey, I have forgiven you from all the offenses that you have done to me. And he would ask me, what are those offenses? I said, I can't remember anymore. Because I have released forgiveness. And I told them, the Bible said, love covers offenses. I remember the love, I don't remember the offense. Because you exercise forgiveness on a daily basis. You can exercise forgiveness to your parents that have offended you, insulted you, said something evil on you, or done evil on you. And even if the offense was done 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago, you can still forgive the person. And even if the person is already dead, you can still forgive the person for forgiveness has nothing to do with the person that you are forgiving. It is something to do with your own emotional, mental, spiritual, and physical health.
Amen.
And I'm telling you, in the realm of the spirits, the enemy is so upset that after he sent you all deception, he surrounded you with all kinds of angry people that day. You met someone at a train who is angry, sat right next to you yelling and screaming. And you met someone at work that is upset with their husband and brought that atmosphere at a job. And you weren't so good with your client that someone yelled at you. And when you went to the mall, the person that says, lady, shortchanged you. You didn't get the right change. You have the reason to be upset. And then you would like to calm down yourself. You bought a gum. You chew the gum. One hour later, you want to spew it out. The gum stuck to your hair. You have the reason to be upset. But you see, if you learn how to release forgiveness, even coincidental activities that happens during the day has no reason to pollute your spirits. Let me tell you this, that offenses is not released to God before sundown, it becomes a poison inside of you. It becomes a habitation to the enemy. Let's go deeper. Tell your neighbor, let's go deeper.
Let's go deeper.
This is what anger is doing in your spirit. Once you are angry, either the anger is validated or not, your emotion is wounded. Okay? And if you don't release forgiveness, you still carry that emotional woundedness the next day. Mm-hmm. And if you don't release forgiveness the next day, that emotional woundedness is carried 2 days later. How did it become a demonic stronghold? People, warfare 101. When you are wounded, woundedness is like a magnet that attracts the devil. He will attach himself to you. Once you are wounded in your emotion, in your spirit, and in the mind, it is an open door for the enemy to attack you. And then if you agree with the enemy, he will attach himself to you. I'm going to give you a good case, for example. You are angry with this person because of what he had spoken to you. You are wounded, and a thought came to your head, why don't you kill the person? You see? That's an attack on your heads. Discernment 101. If you do not know forgiveness, you will agree to that thought, maybe I should kill the person. Now the woundedness becomes a spirit of murder in you. Then you contemplate on how to kill the person. So it started from woundedness, because the enemy find that as an open door, a bridge in your soul and in your spirit to attach themselves to you. Now let's go to a marriage situation. In marriage, if the wife or the husband had wounded or broken your heart, you know what you said in your mind? Maybe I should find another person. That's an attack to your mind to commit infidelity. Now if you agree to the lie of the enemy, then you start looking around to someone who is available who will go to bed with you. You see, the woundedness becomes adultery. Woundedness is an open door, a breach in the soul and the spirit of the man for devils, for demons to attach and attack you. That's why when you release forgiveness to the person, the very words that they have spoken that hurt you, it is broken. Did you notice that when I pray to you, when I sense, when I see that you are heavily laden in your heads, I am breaking every oppression in your mind. Why? I see it in my spirit. It's not saying empty words. I see it in my spirit. Look at you. When we started last Friday, at least with COOS Filipino Ministry, some of you, your eyes were droopy. You're looking down. Your mind is heavy. And then I started breaking the oppression on you. Your eyes started to glitter. Something was broken from you. Some of you, when you entered the room, you were walking like this. You are heavy with some issues in life that you carry. You are not even aware that your back is now starting to get bent because of the anger that you carry. And then I noticed it, and you noticed it, that I started to grab your shoulder and break the yoke that you carry. And you said, I feel light. Because those are weapons in the spirit that I apply to your body that you carry. If there is no discernment, you only see the person. But actually, the posture of the person, how they carry themselves, how you look at their eyes, the movements of their mouth, tell something about the person. Discernment 101. And the more you release forgiveness, the more you can see unforgiveness in other people. I have told you 2 days ago that Satan does not cast out Satan. Jesus taught us that principle. If there is unforgiveness in your heart, you could not break unforgiveness in another person. If there is unforgiveness in your heart, you could not discern unforgiveness in another person. And if the person is sick because of unforgiveness, you could never heal the sickness because it is brought by unforgiveness, and you as a person that prays has that unforgiveness as well. Now, one thing that you need to understand, that's why in the body of Christ, only few moves in the power of healing, because they don't understand basic principles of forgiveness. I always tell myself, I said this to God, I am not going to allow unforgiveness to poison my soul and my spirit, because it's not only affecting my personal breakthrough in prayer, but it is affecting the breakthrough when I pray for other people. I'm thinking about you. I am thinking that the prayer can take you out of your sickness. I'm thinking of the prayer that can take you out of your societal thoughts and inclination. I am thinking of the prayer that is going to heal your mind and set you free, that you can become a blessing to other people. I'm thinking about you. But you see, these are principles that we can discover in the Word of God, because the Lord Jesus Christ has laid to us the principles already. Sometimes, when the anger of the person is too much, you are going to see demonic strongholds of violence. You know the cases of schizophrenia? Mental illness, you will see a lot of violence in those personalities. And one thing that I have noticed, this is already out of experience, that from our clients that we have delivered from schizophrenia, there are histories of sexual abuse. So they were violated in their bodies, but since they were not taught how to forgive, the enemy comes in to grab their emotion, grab their mind, oppress them with violence and anger. And the anger is given to themselves and to other people. And they make other people, their families, become miserable. No, because they're helpless to take care of their bodies. Anger, if not released to God, will become murder. becomes violence. And I'm telling you, these people, your life doesn't have to be perfect when you come to God. That's why you continue to attend church. You continue to attend, you know, Bible studies and conferences where you can be taught. Because the purpose of that is this: to renew your mind and to teach you kingdom principles that will set you free. Because the Lord Jesus Christ himself said, it is for freedom that I have set you free. Freedom is so beautiful. Glory to God. Let's go to the next slide. If anger is retained after sundown, I taught you already that it becomes a demonic stronghold. Here's what. After anger is retained, after sundown, it is going to bring you to a place of what the Bible said, you are in the darkness. That's 1 John 1:9-11. Let's go there. I want you to become familiar with the Word of God. First John chapter 1, 9 to 11. I think this should be 1 John chapter 2, not 1. It should be chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2, 9 to 11. Anyone who claims to be in the light but hates his brother is still in the darkness. Whoever loves his brother lives in the light, and there is nothing in him to make him stumble. But whoever hates his brother is in the darkness and walks around in the darkness. Amazing. So meaning, once we have hatred or anger in our heart, we are still in the place of darkness. I remember several months ago, I was in a dream state. Say with me, she was in a dream state. In the dream state, the Holy Spirit took my spirits and he brought me to places. While I was having an encounter with the Holy Ghost, I saw a lot of very dark figures. And I was having this conversation with the Holy Spirit in a dream. And I asked him, I said, why is it that there are so many demons in this place? And the Holy Spirit replied to me. He said, they are not demons. They are wicked people. The Lord showed me in the spirit realm how wicked people look like. They are in complete darkness, that their color is pitch black. Wow. Let me see. Oh, here, Judy. Judy, is that black or navy blue? Your tongue, is that black? It's navy blue. How about you, sister? Is that black? Okay, can you stand up a little bit? I just like for them to see, to show them something here. That's a black color. In the realm of the spirit, the Lord showed to me that the color of the wicked is 50 times darker than that. Can you imagine? Thank you. So now they have an idea on what it meant that you are in the darkness. I thought they were demons. And the Holy Spirit told me, they are not demons, they are the wicked. And as we were walking, one thing that I have noticed, the wicked people saw the brightness in me. They were so attracted to the light that's beaming out of me that I saw them trying to grab my lights. And they could not touch my lights. But they were just so, because they couldn't get my light, you know what, they were so upset and they become so angry. And I asked the Holy Ghost in my dream state, I said, why is it that they are so dark? And the Holy Ghost said, this is what will happen if people doesn't have the light of the world. That's a revelatory dream. The answer was very simple. That's what will happen if people doesn't have the light of the world. If we carry anger with us, we are in the darkness, according to 1 John chapter 2, 9-11. In the realm of the spirit, your color is black. You know, when I go to places, when I am invited to do some revival meetings, this one is a conference meeting. When I am invited to go to a revival meetings where there are so many unbelievers that are invited, I always do the color factor. After that dream that the Spirit of God has given me, I knew now the color factor. When the person enters the room, when I see darkness, I knew it. They are living in hatred and anger. So if you are a prophetic person and a deliverance minister at the same time, you go right away and break in the oppression of anger that controls the person. You're getting it, right? Glory to God. Okay. One time, I told the Lord, I said, God, I am doing a lot of healing ministry. Sometimes I can do like 3 hours in one person, especially if it's a very complicated case. And I told the Lord, this kind of 3 hours healing ministry is only good if you have 1 or 2 people who can wait. But you are, if you are in a meeting like what we did last night, that so many are waiting, I don't have 3 hours for one person. And I told the Lord, God, if you can help me, you can make my job easy. Then one day, the Holy Ghost appeared in my dream. And he said to me, I am going to open the eyes of your spirit that you will see exactly the location in the body of the person where demons are attached to their body. That made my job so easy. And the first person that God brought to me that week came to see me that week in my house. And she came into my living room. And the person was crying. She has these bloodshot eyes. And I asked her, I said, what's wrong with you? And she said this. You listen to this very carefully. She said to me, I was cursed and I was embarrassed by my brother in front of my boss. And she was crying because she felt so humiliated in front of her boss. So I said, I want you to sit down. She did not know it, that a week ago, the Lord, the Holy Ghost, visited me in my dream and told me, I am going to open the eyes of your spirit that you will see exactly where the demons are attached to their body. And I said, I want you to sit down. I have to do something with you. When she sat down, I said, just relax, okay? Okay. I grabbed something on her right shoulder and I took it out of her body and threw it away in the name of Jesus. And she said to me, what was that? I feel so light. And her condition has so improved after 5 minutes. She's not crying anymore. She doesn't look depressed anymore. She wasn't angry anymore. And she asked me, what did you took in my body? She did not realize it, that when she steps into my living room, the Lord already opened the eyes of my spirit. A deep noose like a frog was hanging on her shoulder. I took it out of her body, and in less than 5 minutes, she felt better. But listen to this. When she entered the room, she was crying. Her eyes were bloodshot because she said she was cursed by her brother and she was offended by her brother. Cursing released the demon spirit to attach to her because she was emotionally wounded. One thing that I want you to understand, praise, say with me, praise.
Praise
releases the presence of God.
Releases the presence of God.
Cursing releases demons.
Cursing releases demons.
If you have the habit of cursing, you are still a worker of wickedness, working with the devil, releasing demons every time you speak. Shirabakata. Ministers, I don't know how many ministers are here. And even if you are not a minister, if you are a believer, and if you are in a hostile family situation where you are married to someone who curse, your children curse, what is your protection? I know it, you know the blood of Jesus, but what do you do with those words that you hear every day that curse you? This is where you need to use the fire of God to destroy the atmosphere that is brought about by cursing. You see, you still pray your normal prayer. You still pray your regular intercession. But without releasing the fire of God, those curses that they have spoken in the atmosphere is what create the heaviness in the house. Glory to God. You want the seed of anger to be destroyed. You don't want the seed to become a root. It started with a seed. Think about in the natural. There is a seed. The seed evolves to become a root. And then it will start to grow leaves. Kill the seed before it evolves to become a root. Destroy it right away. So how do you destroy it? You come to the Lord. You confess what people have done to you. You release them forgiveness. And then you receive the blood of Jesus, or you take the Lord's Supper or the communion to heal yourself. You need to understand that the Lord Jesus Christ has provided a way in order for us to heal ourselves. One of them is the communion. So after you release forgiveness to the person, take a communion that your broken emotion will be healed by the blood of Jesus. Growing up, I grew up in an atmosphere where my mother is a believer and my dad is the unbeliever. My dad only came to the Lord at the last minute before he died. So we grew up in a family atmosphere where he is cursing in the morning, cursing during noontime, cursing during evening, and there is a curse in the middle. Can you imagine how many demons would he release in the atmosphere? And we grew up bitter and wounded. And I remember my sister, she was only in high school and she has already this arthritic pain on her knees. Where did it come from? Don't you know that arthritis is a demonic affliction? I'm going to bring you there in a few. Where did it come from? And I remember that, you know, I have this terrible migraine that would leave my head. And I was only in high school. I did not realize that his constant cursing is releasing an atmosphere where our bodies are getting affected. Because you know what? Our bodies were not created by the Lord to become a container of the curse. We were created to worship God. But look, see what the enemy is doing. The enemy is putting all the curse in us. And the body starts to break down. That's why you're getting arthritis. You're getting all kinds of headache and even Crohn's disease, the diarrhea, the abnormal intestinal problem. They are demonic. It needs to be broken. It needs to be destroyed. Because the body was not intended for that. This body was created by the Lord to praise Him, to love Him, to worship Him. But because of sin and iniquity, people are putting curse there. People are putting all kinds of garbage, all kinds of evil and nasty conversation. Look at me, people. If you can talk nice to other people, walk away.
That's right.
Don't listen to those gossips. Don't listen to those complaining. If you can pray to the person to break the spirit of complaining and criticism, if you can't do it in that level yet, because you are not in that level in the spirit yet, walk away. Do yourself a favor, because that spirit will go to you, and before you know it, you are discouraged. You need to understand that anointing can be imparted. Say with me, importance. Anointings can be imparted. At the same time, evil spirits can also be given to you. That's why when you are talking to people that are always negative, they are giving that spirit of negativity to you. I don't want to be surrounded with people that will always say, they don't have hope. The spirit of hopelessness is also given to you. I don't want to be surrounded with people that always talks about money. I need money, but you don't have to talk about it every hour. You know why? The spirit of mammon will come to you and money will control your minds. I don't want to be surrounded with people who magnifies their sickness. Instead of talking about the healing of God and the promise of God about healing in their body, they magnify their sickness. Today I have a headache. 2 hours from now I have a toothache. This afternoon my knees are aching. And the text is about toothache, earache, joint ache. It's all about sickness. If you do not know how to break the spirit of sickness in a person, stop receiving the text before that spirit becomes your atmosphere.
Amen.
But if you already know how to destroy that spirit, you text back the sister, I break that spirit of sickness and negative confession in Jesus' name. The blood of Jesus will heal you today as I speak.
Amen.
Try to text 10 of your sisters, and if everyone is talking like that, I'm telling you, at the end of the day, that person is healed. Why? The oppression in our mind is broken by a powerful prayer.
Amen.
But if no one is answering her back like that and you say like this, ah, me too! I have a migraine, so now it's the two of you. So now sickness has reinforced itself. Sickness has strengthened itself. You just stop and destroy this in the name of Jesus. I am telling you, in this life, we have encountered a lot of deaths. You know, sometimes I pray to so many people, and some of you, you do not know how unclean you are in the spirits. And when I lay my hands on you, some of those spirits that when I place my hand on you, I break it from you. And sometimes some of them do not go into the pit of the abyss because I forget to send them to the pit of the abyss. You see, the problems of demons is habitation. If you don't give them a place where to go, they will follow you. You owe them a residence. Why? You remove me from someone's body. Where are you going? Send me now. That's why in the gospel, when the person encountered Jesus, they begged, Lord, please send us to the pits. They are desperate for habitation. Say with me, habitation.
Habitation.
If you rebuke and cast out a spirit of anger in a person, if you don't give it a habitation, you, the deliverer, that it will follow you. You owe that spirit a habitation. You need to send them to places where they need to go. Send them to hell, that's fine. Send them to a pit of the abyss, that's fine. Don't send them to the house of another person. I don't if you have noticed it, that there are churches that the place is so heavy. When you enter the place, you can feel that foreboding heaviness in the room. There were so many spirits carried by congregants in the church, and they never kicked out that spirit in that room. It stays there. You see, demons are not smart. If you don't tell them where they should go or where they should live, it will keep on following you. Why? You owe them a residence. And sometimes I forget to send them to the abyss. Why? I pray to 100 people. You can forget, you too. Sometimes you're even praying, you already forget where is your eyeglasses. It's only on top of your nose. Am I right? Yes. How much more if you are praying to 100 people, sometimes 500, you will also forget. And some of them, like I said, why is it that the tip of my finger is itchy? And the Holy Spirit will tell me, well, a demonet attached to the tip of your finger. Go, Chris! I rebuke you, and here's a surprise, the fire of God to burn you. Now to the pit of the abyss in Jesus' name. It will go. We did some invasive praying in a certain place in Iloilo City when I visited Iloilo City during the burial of my dad last September. And I went back to the hotel. You see, the enemy knows the enemy. In the eyes of the enemy, I am the enemy. In my eyes, they are also my enemy. We don't like each other. After we did an invasive praying, Saul was with me. She went somewhere. I entered the hotel where I stayed. When I opened the hotel, all my hair stood up. You know what that meant? Sometimes you enter a building or a place, you can understand it, but it is so spooky. It is so eerie, all your hairs will stand up. Something is not normal in this place. You call it haunted house. If that spirit will go inside a person, you call it demon possession. When I stepped into the new room that I stepped into, all my hair stood up, as in really standing up like that. If you can get a photo, you will see that it's not in that normal height. And the Holy Spirit told me, someone is hiding behind the curtain. Like that, I said, Lord, because the curtain is white, I said, which part of the room? I didn't show any sign of fear. And the Lord said, right next to you. So I entered the room, my hair is all standing up. Not really stand up in this height, it's too much. Only a few. But I think you know what I meant. Yes. Behind the curtain. And I said, I rebuke you spirits hiding behind the curtain. I'm here now in the room, get out in Jesus' name. That eerie atmosphere left the room, and I started to pray in tongues. The atmosphere shifted. One thing that you need to know, that when demonic spirits enter a room, they bring with them an atmosphere of heaviness. That's why it needs to be broken. Once you don't release forgiveness to a person, the next day another person angers you, that's another darkness coming to you. And then a month later, you get upset with your boss and you still do not exercise forgiveness. Another darkness comes to you. Before you know it, you are 50 years old and you already have an offense to like 500 people. I delivered a person one time and I said, make a list of everyone that have offended you. And she said, I'll be back to you next week. I was like thinking, why next week? Can't you write it down now? Because I'm thinking maybe you were only offended by 10 people. That's easy to remember. When she came back to me, I almost fell off my chair. Because the list that she was given to me looks like a telephone directory. I said, this is a book. I could not believe that this is how many people have angered you. And it makes sense to me why she is so sick in her body. And she is so young. She has all kinds of sickness in her body. She is bleeding. Something is wrong with her breast. Something is wrong with her stomach. Something is wrong with her hair. Something is wrong with her skin. I can understand if you have offenses as thick as a phone book. I am telling you, you are lucky to survive. Your body was not created by God to retain unforgiveness. Eventually, it will implode. And I said, now it makes sense why you have all of this. And I'm telling you, in my own journey of forgiveness, I have to forgive my dad in a length of 7 years. And I'm telling you why it was not an easy journey. Because of so much pain, abuse, emotional, physical beating, rejection, neglect, irresponsibility, and there is no godly virtue that he had passed on to us, I have to go through a 7 year of process of forgiveness. And there is one thing that I would like to teach you. At the time, I would like to pray for my husband. And every time I will attempt to pray to my husband, the Holy Spirit will say, pray to your dads. And I told the Holy Spirit, I prayed to my dad yesterday. It's my husband's turn today. You see, sometimes we're like that. We want to outsmart the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost said, no, pray to your dad again. And I prayed for my dad again. You know what I did for 7 years? I just keep on forgiving him all the offenses and all the words that he had spoken against me, all the lies that he had spoken against me. I have to break it in my mind in the name of Jesus Christ. Every time I release forgiveness to him, I can get a breakthrough to pray to my husband. Ladies, I want you to learn something. If you have a bad relationship with your father, it will affect your husband. And husband is the same thing. If you don't have a good relationship with your wife, with your mother, it will affect your relationship with your wife. And don't be surprised, once you pray to your wife, the Lord will bring you to release forgiveness to your mother. Because the way you treat your mother is the same way that you will treat your wife. The way you treat your father is the same way that you will treat your husband. Don't you know, ladies, if you are single, the person that you are going to marry will look like your dad in habits and in behavior. But if you become a believer, and if your dad is an unbeliever, you said, Lord, I don't want that DNA of unbelief to be in my husband, then you broke something in the spirit. But assuming that your father is godly, and you are the second generation of godly believers in the house, chances are the person that you will marry behaves like your dad. Why? Because that's the main figure who has the closest influence in you. If mommy is godly, I won't be surprised if James will marry someone that looks like mommy and behaves like mommy. Why? Because mommy is the ideal godly example that I am looking up to. I even hear my associate one time ministering to his daughter, said, Janine, the man that you are going to marry looks like me, sings like me, speaks like me, and loves you like the way I do. That's why in the series of unforgiveness that I did to my dad, every time I forgive my dad, my relationship to my husband gets better. So my husband said, continue to forgive him. Okay, so I keep on forgiving him. So it was a series of journey of 7 years. My communication with my husband improved because of the forgiveness that I give to my father. And I did not realize it, that my wrong attitude with my father is spilling over to my husband. So if my husband would like to tell me, hey, you have a wrong behavior, actually, he is reprimanding my dad because it came from him. Spirits, they are passed on from one generation to the next. But they can be broken in prayer. They can be broken by repentance. They can be broken by confession. And we break them by the blood of Jesus. I am telling you, I have so forgiven my dad that when I was young, everyone was telling me, I look like my dad. And I told all my relatives, I look like my dad. And my relatives would say, you don't look like your dad at all. So at my dad's casket when he was dead, I stand a little bit and look at the mirror. And I look at the dead body. They're right. I don't look like him at all. You know why? I have so much forgiven him that it was the anointing of godliness, the DNA of my Father God that is beaming out of my face. And what they see is the glory of God radiating in me. Amen. Physically, I don't even look like my dad anymore. God has so cut off the DNA of wickedness and evil and changed me to totally becoming a different person. One thing that I would like to tell you is this. If you have anger to a person, even though the person is not your relative, if that anger is retained in you, you will look like the person that you are angry with. That's revelation to you. You know why? It's a spirit. The woundedness. The devil attached himself to the woundedness. And the personality of the spirit of anger that was given to you by your offender is now to you. So the offender and the offended, they have now the same personality. Why? Because the spirit of anger was given from this person to that person. The same spirit, the same personality. That's why you will look like the person that you are offended with. Mm. Revelation of the things of the spirits. That's why when you release forgiveness to a person, you will never look like the person that has offended you. You know who will look you look like? You will look more godlier because forgiveness looks good on you. Amen. Glory to God.